All right, I'll call the meeting of the February 22nd Board of Selectmen meeting to order. First item on the agenda is the minutes of February 16th. Has everybody reviewed the minutes?
Yep.
Any changes or additions?
They look good.
It's good.
Okay. All right, I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of February 16th.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item on the agenda, we have warrants. We have a vendor warrant of $114,104, a payroll warrant of $95,719, and a payroll deduction warrant of $25,261. I'll make a motion that we accept those warrants.
Second.
I have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item is meetings attended by select board members since last Monday.
None in the last week for me.
Yeah, it was a quiet week. All right. Next item is citizens' concern. Nelson, you have a concern.
Yes. Thank you. I'll try to be brief. I know that you folks have already spent time in this prior meeting, but I don't think that it was addressed adequately, so that's why I'm here this evening. This is about the sleepover, or the fact that the Congregational Church was not able to use the church facility for a sleepover at the Martin Luther King March. So I just had a couple of questions and a couple of comments that I would like to make. First of all, I believe that the letter that was sent to the select board by the pastor was sent well in advance of the February 1st meeting. Is that correct? Do we know when that was received?
I don't remember exactly what day.
I could look it up, but...
Okay.
There was a week's delay in getting it onto the agenda.
So. Okay, so there was not another meeting when that could have been brought up earlier.
All right. Well, what's the basic issue, Nelson?
Well, I'll get to that. But was this brought up at the first opportunity at the selectmen's meeting, or was it held back? That's what I'm curious to know.
It may not have been. If it was delayed, it was entirely my
Okay. All right. That satisfies that concern. So I guess the other questions that I have are this. Mr. Bick or Bob, you said that you first learned of this incident when someone called your wife of this, your concern, and said that there were 100 people.
They estimated they were going to feed 100 people.
That would be feeding 100 people. So was your concern based on the number of people, 100 people?
Well, that would have been, yes, part of it, yes.
So that was your primary concern. Okay.
But also the concern, I know because of the laws, that in places of assembly, that people cannot spend overnight evenings or through the whole evening or sleepovers, if that's what you want to call it, without the a previous application and the certain procedures. It's totally allowable by law. Mm-hmm. And I've got a copy in the law here you can take with you and read it if you like.
I have a copy of the law.
But it just has to be done in advance.
Yeah. So I'm aware of it. You're aware of that now. But were you aware of it at the time? When you called Jim Cerrone initially, were you aware that that was the case, that there was a law?
Yes.
To that effect, you were. Because that's not the test, that's not what you said at the February 1st meeting. What you said exactly was, I called Jim Cerrone to find out what the building commission's requirement on that and to see if there was.
All right, Nelson, we're not gonna do this here. Bob is the fire chief, and he's in charge of that. You want to speak to him after the meeting and ask him those questions, that's fine.
I think that this matter was mishandled by Bob as both select person and also as fire chief.
If you have a problem with Bob as the fire chief, you can talk to him after the meeting.
I believe that Bob was acting both as fire chief and selectman when he addressed this issue. And I think that this is the appropriate place to bring it up.
I don't think it is.
I would like to have 5 more minutes of your time.
Not if it continues like this, okay? Bob is our fire chief.
Mm-hmm.
He's the one in charge of making sure the rules and the laws are carried out in town, okay? You're coming in here very accusatory, and we're not gonna go with that.
Okay.
You wanna talk to Bob privately about this? As fire chief, that's fine.
Okay, then let me just make one more question or one more suggestion. As a select person or as a fire chief in this town, if you genuinely thought there were going to be 100 people coming into town expecting to spend the night here, and on short notice, within 24 hours, found find out that they weren't going to have a place to stay, as a fire chief, as selectman, would you not have been concerned about what might result from that?
Yes, I was concerned.
Or even curious?
I was concerned.
Did anyone give any thought to making the elementary school available? That's a building that is permitted for this purpose.
All right, this is something you can talk about with Bob privately, okay?
Okay, then I have one final statement. The select board in this town is supposed to represent the majority view of the citizens of the town. That did not happen in this instance. That did not happen. What happened was inappropriate. It represented an individual ideology, and it represented a constituency. It didn't represent the interests of the town. This was handled poorly.
All right.
That's my
comment. I don't agree with you, and you're giving us one side of the opinion. All right, and again, handle it with Bob privately. Bob is our fire chief. He's the one in charge of making sure these rules and laws are carried out. Thanks for coming in.
This law was selectively applied.
Thanks for coming in.
Absolutely.
Well, I felt it was an inappropriate move, but...
The law is the law. What are you going to do?
Yeah, I know.
All right, next item on the agenda.
I think we have another citizen's concern.
I do have a citizen's concern. Hello, nice to see you after
Stein, how are you?
On television. My concern is the plowing of the roads. I live on Shelburne Falls Road, and I live up by Wilder Hill End. Mm-hmm. And the first two storms I didn't worry about because I figured people are getting their act together. But the last storm, I actually called, is it Ron Sweet?
Mm-hmm.
Who's the,
mm-hmm.
What do you call that, highway
person? Highway superintendent.
So I called him and I said, is there a way to clear Shelburne Falls Road better? Especially, there's two places. One, just beyond me, so between me and Hart Road, between Wilder Hill Road and Hart Road. It was like the west side of the road had not been plowed well. And I was thinking, did this stuff come from the trees or what? Anyway, and then coming down Dill Hill. So it seems as if the plow is going down the center of the street, which is okay when you can see, but coming down Dill Hill, if I'm in the center and somebody's coming up, I'm really anxious about not getting over onto the ice at this point in time. So I'm just wondering if there's a way to have that addressed. I called Ron and I left him a message.
Did it look like the road wasn't plowed on one side or something?
It looks like they're going down the center.
And
it looks like the sand, if there is any, is just in the center. Not, you know, this side and this side. And it didn't ever used to be like that. But this year, I don't know if the plow guys have changed or what,
well,
but anyway.
They've rearranged their plowing methods. And I think that's probably gonna have to be addressed because what they're doing now is they're plowing it with a truck with a wing on it. Mm. So the truck is offsetting the center of the road. If this is the center of the highway, the wing is covering the right-hand side going out. The plow on the truck is over the center line, taking out part of the other lane at the same time.
Oh, okay. I see that.
And because of the angle of the roads, like this, the pitch of the road, that plow riding on that left-hand side isn't scraping down tight to the road.
Oh, that makes sense.
So that, okay.
So the right
because
side.
Somebody else mentioned that to me.
Yeah, it's very scary on Dill Hill, especially. But there are other places that it's like...
And it's a known fact that those wings don't scrape as good as a plow does.
Mm-hmm. Right. And that does have to be addressed. And the person who said something to me said, it's not being plowed to the edge of the road.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean,
that would be the wing that keeps it from doing that. So maybe we need to...
Yeah,
that should be addressed.
It could be the wing can be adjusted. I'm happy to bring that to Ron.
Let's talk to Ron about that.
Yeah.
The other thing is, I had who's the tree warden?
Colin Burt.
Yeah. So I called him to ask about a tree on my property, and he said he would pass that along to Ron, and Ron would be in touch. And that was at least 4 or 5 months ago. So I just am waiting to hear about.
And what's your address again?
Oh, make sure he gets back to you promptly on that.
Okay.
I just, you know, I didn't hear from him, so.
All right, we'll look
anyway,
into both those.
But the plowing is, it's scary, and I know that snow is coming again, and I just am hoping that maybe they'll make a second pass, or the second day when it's ice, they'll go by with some sand.
Okay, great.
And thank you for putting up the don't take the salt signs. It said, what is it? I saw those two things. It said, keep out.
Yes.
It might be useful to say, keep out, this salt is not for public use. So, but anyway, thank you for putting those up.
Thanks for coming in.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Who put that sign up?
That was Ron.
I had called and said people were just coming in and taking the salt, and I thought we weren't supposed to.
Oh, okay. Thanks, son.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Nice to see you, Tom.
Good to see you, son.
Good to see you.
Hey, what's your name again? Stein, Frank.
Stein.
Oh, okay. Okay. Don, you're up.
Nope. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
I believe the board has received a packet from me, which I would like to just to quickly take you through. Before we actually go through the handouts, I guess I'd just like to share with you a couple of observations. First and foremost, I want to begin by sharing with the board how cooperative, frankly, all the employees have been during the course of the study, and particularly a town administrator. As an outsider, when you come into a community and you really begin discussing what is clearly an important issue to employees, and that's how they're paid, you never know how that's going to be received. But I can assure you that, to the best of my recollection, it's been a while since I met with all the employees here, but I've met with them as a group, I've met with them individually, and I can assure you they're concerned, meaning, I think, and I may have said this to the board when I first met with you, the number one concern every single town that I work in is communication. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily about the money, but yet when we talk about compensation right away, people have dollars and cents on their minds, and when in reality, I think I would submit to you that, as I'll take you through the process that I've now followed, I think it's really more about communication than it is anything else. And the key to communication, particularly in the public sector, is establishing a set of guidelines that everyone's familiar with, everyone understands the process. And if you ever want to change the process, obviously it can be changed whenever you feel it's necessary, but it's a process that everyone hopefully understands and agrees to. And I think that's the real critical aspect of what I want to share with you tonight, because I mean, ultimately, yes, it is about the numbers, it is about the bottom line, mm-hmm. the cost and so forth. I would submit to you the real question ultimately, when it's all said and done, is how you spend the money that you feel you can afford with respect to compensation, mm-hmm. more so than it is how much you can afford. And you know as well, if not better than anyone, how constrained you are from a municipal budgeting standpoint relative mm-hmm. to having funds available to do anything. Mm-hmm. And sure. really, I would encourage you to think of compensation really as just another responsibility you have relative to paying your employees. And I think, again, the critical question ultimately that I'm trying to help you address is how to spend the money. Mm-hmm. When you finally make that determination. So the first page of the handout, very simply, was just reiterating what I shared with you first time we met, and that is the goal or purpose of the study. Mm-hmm. And I just always like to begin by talking about that just because I think if there is any aspect of local government that is clearly not really understood well, this is it, meaning compensation. So I'd like to begin by making sure people understand that what we've done basically is conduct a market study. This has not been a cost of living study. So the issue of cost of living as it relates to compensation really has never been a factor that we've taken into consideration or that we've incorporated into this study. Right from the get-go, the purpose of the study has been to develop, as we say in this goal statement, a consistent, which really means fair, and at the same time equitable, which I think really means competitive, way of paying positions and employees so that when it's all said and done, you're able to communicate to anyone and everyone that has a vested interest in compensation, how their compensation, whether it's from a position standpoint and or from an employee standpoint, relates to the marketplace. Mm-hmm. All right, if the town at some point ever wanted to establish a true cost of living component to your compensation plan, that really would be a separate issue. And we can talk about that, but again, I just want to begin by making sure that people understand this was not a cost of living study. Mm-hmm. The three objectives that I listed on the handout, those were the three things that I indicated right from the get-go that we proposed to accomplish. I'm pleased to report to you that they've all been accomplished, they've been completed. Meaning specifically, we've now written job descriptions in a consistent way. So the format of every job description in the town, whether it's for regular positions, part-time, temporary, stipend, it doesn't make any difference. A job description is a job description. I would submit to you now that in approving this plan, you are in effect establishing a format that all job descriptions should be written in, mm-hmm. with no exception. Again, you can always change the format if you want, but I think it should be, as I've now, and I will continue to emphasize again, writing job descriptions needs to be done in a consistent way, and we've done that. And so they're written to be what we call accurate descriptions, and again, I may have mentioned to you when we first met, accurate in this context means two things. It means accurately describing what employees are required to do today, mm-hmm. and at the same time, it means describing the knowledge, skill, and ability that's required to carry out those job duties. All of that information now is in a job description. Mm-hmm. So it's formatted in such a way that's clear and it's easy to understand, and you'll see in the final report that I'll provide to you what that format looks like, mm-hmm. and you'll see that it contains sufficient information to basically communicate to an employee how their position is being compensated. Mm-hmm. The second objective, another word to use besides compensated, is really how the position has been classified, which really means compared to other positions. So in writing the job description again, we've written them intentionally with the objective of communicating to an employee how their position has ultimately been classified. Again, it really means describing the knowledge, the ability, the skill, the so-called mm-hmm. minimum qualifications that are required to carry out anything and everything they ever do, right? And so whenever they're asked to do something, if they feel, an employee feels, that their job description does not accurately describe the knowledge, skill, and ability to carry out what might be in their eyes a new job duty, well, that's a perfectly acceptable, understandable concern to have. Your job description now has been written in such a way to answer that question, meaning does your current job description already describe the knowledge, ability, and skill to carry out what you might perceive as a brand new job duty or not, as the case may be. Mm-hmm. And so the job description becomes the basis for determining if an employee feels they shouldn't do something because it's not part of their so-called job. The job description now will tell you, and I mean specifically the minimum qualifications section of the job description, whether they should or shouldn't be required to do something. So it becomes a legal document. And again, from a communication standpoint, hopefully explains to an employee whenever they're asked to do something, whether they should or shouldn't be required to do it. Or another way to say that is whether they should or shouldn't be paid more money, if that's the case. So in developing a classification plan, we've used a position rating system, which basically consists of a set of minimum qualifications, so-called, again, knowledge, ability, and skill, that are broken down basically into 13 criteria. Mm-hmm. And again, the details, the specifics, you'll get to see when you look at the job descriptions, let alone if you want to look at the rating system itself. But as a result of applying a rating system consisting of 13 evaluation criteria, I'm now recommending to you tonight that there would be 6 classification levels established for regular positions in the town of Conway. The word regular, just so we're clear as far as the terminology goes, really basically means an employee that's required to work 52 weeks a year, mm-hmm. whether it's full-time, part-time, 10 hours, 2 hours, 20 hours. That's a different issue. That's a budget issue, more so than it is whether or not the position should be ultimately grouped with other positions that meet the same basic standard, and that is required to work 52 weeks a year. So essentially what you'll have from a compensation standpoint is a compensation plan consisting of regular positions, stipend positions, which means by definition they're paid a fixed amount of money, or they may be paid on what we call a temporary basis, which means they're only paid when you require them to work, mm-hmm. as opposed to regularly scheduled to work. So what you're ultimately going to see is a plan consisting of regular positions or a regular compensation plan, so-called temporary positions, which means you pay them when you require them to work, or in whether you pay them a fixed amount of money or an hourly rate of pay, they meet the definition of being temporary, mm-hmm. which means not regularly scheduled to work all year long. Okay? And the compensation plan that's been developed, I think the real critical issue there, which I'll share with you tonight, is how we're recommending you use the market data as a guide to help you develop salary ranges for each of the respective classification levels. Mm-hmm. So I just want to repeat that for a second. We're using market data as a guide, not as the be-all and end-all, but as a guide to help you basically define the word competitive, mm-hmm. both in terms of paying a position and paying an employee. So as a result of this study, the process that we followed will in effect define that term as it relates to paying a position and paying an employee. So you'll know, I'll know, anyone that has a vested interest or is a stakeholder, has a concern about compensation, basically they'll know whether they're being paid quote-unquote competitively or not. Mm-hmm. And we'll get into it in a minute in terms of how I'm recommending for you to define that term. Again, as it relates to both a position as well as an employee. Mm-hmm. So those are the three objectives. Again, all three of them have been completed. And as I just mentioned a minute ago, from a classification standpoint, we're recommending that a classification plan be established for regular positions consisting of six grade levels. Mm-hmm. If you jump to the third page of the handout, all I'm sharing with you there, just so people know, we actually surveyed 10 communities in the marketplace. Mm-hmm. How we surveyed them and how we propose to use the data, as it indicates in this handout, we use both operational and demographic criteria to select communities on a position-by-position basis. Mm-hmm. So not necessarily every single position or every single community was used for every single position, mm-hmm. right? And for the simple reason, you don't need to do it that way.
Sure.
So from a credibility standpoint, I think it's important that ultimately you're comfortable using the market data so that it can be used, as I said a minute ago, to define the word competitive. And we'll get into specifically how we're proposing to do that in a minute. The next chart just simply shares with you from an overall standpoint the salary range structure for each of the six grade levels. If you look at them as a total compensation plan, what I'm sharing with you are just some percentage numbers. In other words, the proposed salary range structure, when you look at the minimums of each of the six grade levels, and you look mm-hmm. at that just as a group, compared to the market data, they're roughly about 8%, almost 9% below the average minimum of the market data we collected. Whereas the midpoint of the proposed salary ranges is roughly about 1.75% below the survey average midpoint. And the average maximum, or I should say the proposed maximums of the salary ranges, each of the six salary ranges, compared to the survey average maximum data overall, is about 13% greater than the average of the market data that we've collected. Mm-hmm. The reason why I like to share with you these numbers is that one of the policies that I'm going to recommend to the board that you establish is essentially part of defining the word competitive, that whether an individual employee and or a position is within plus or minus 10% of whatever market data you're looking at is a good way at least to indicate whether or not either the position and or the employee is being paid competitively. It's just a reasonable number. There's nothing magical about 10%. The policy will basically say if you're paid within 10%, you're being paid competitively. If you're paid within 10 to 20%, then it's an indicator that your position and or your own salary might not be competitive with the marketplace. And I say might not be only because it depends on the credibility of the data once you look at it. The other number that I just wanted to share with you on this chart was when you look at the current salaries of the employees and you compare them to the proposed benchmark, and we'll get into the term benchmark in a minute. Benchmark is basically the midpoint of each of the salary ranges. The overall comparison of salaries, and I'm talking about regular positions now, not stipend forms of compensation, is roughly about 3.82% below the average benchmark for each of the six grade levels. So when you see the ranges in a minute, and you look at the benchmark, which is like the midpoint of each range, and you look at all six benchmarks compared to the salaries of the employees in the respective grade levels, they're roughly almost 4% below that benchmark, which to me means, again, competitive. Just keep in mind that plus or minus 10% is a guide to follow. Developing the ranges, as I mentioned, we've used both demographic and operational criteria to select what we're calling comparable communities or comparable towns. And it's really both. It isn't just demographic, meaning it's not just contiguous communities, but it's other municipalities and specifically positions in other municipalities that have been determined to be operationally comparable to a position in the town of Conway. And so I think it's very important. Sometimes there's a real misunderstanding when you look at the marketplace. Typically, what many, many communities do is they only look at demographic criteria. They really don't take into consideration operational criteria, which I think, again, is critical to doing it consistently, but also doing it competitively. So each of the salary ranges have been based on market salary data, where the average midpoint of the market salary data for positions in each grade level has now become what I referred to a minute ago as the term, the benchmark of within a salary range. So when you look at a chart, as we'll get to in a minute, once we've classified our group positions, we've taken the survey data for each grade level and the positions that we surveyed within each grade level, and specifically the average midpoint of the survey data for each group or each grade level. And that average number, so if there's, let's say, three positions in a grade level and we surveyed all three positions, you literally add the average midpoint of those three positions and divide by three to give you what I'm referring to now as a benchmark salary, which is nothing more than a guide to use within a salary range that is being recommended. So the minimum and the maximum of each salary range that you'll see in order to meet the standard of being developed consistently have been developed linked directly to the benchmark. So we've used market data to develop a benchmark salary within a range. From the benchmark, we've then taken a percentage of the benchmark to be the minimum, and we've multiplied the minimum by a percentage to be the maximum. So everything is driven in each salary range by the benchmark number, which again is a market-driven number. The minimum and the maximum numbers under this type of compensation plan are nothing more than guides. No one automatically gets paid a minimum number. No one automatically gets paid a maximum number. And we'll get into the specifics when we'll look at an actual chart so you have a better understanding of what the numbers really look like. But from a conceptual standpoint, what I'm suggesting in order to maintain the compensation plan competitively with the marketplace, that you use market data that you collect on a regular basis, and based on how positions are classified or grouped, you take the average midpoint. In other words, rule out the lows and the highs of the data you collect, focus on the midpoint, and then take the average of the midpoint for each group, and that becomes a benchmark salary number within a proposed range. And again, your minimum and your maximum numbers really can be theoretically or technically whatever you feel they need to be so that they're wide enough to be competitive with the market data. And there'll be a chart that we'll look at in a minute that'll hopefully make it a little bit clearer for you. So the competitiveness of each salary range is based on market data, the salary of the employee, as well as how long the employee has been in their respective position. So essentially, you have three criteria to define the word competitive as it relates to the position. So the position is paid based on a salary range, and the employee is paid somewhere between the minimum and the maximum. What I'm suggesting is that in defining the word competitive for each range, that essentially we're now able to use three criteria: the market data itself, which is that average midpoint of the data we collect, the salaries of the employees, whatever they happen to be at that point in time when you're looking at the salary ranges, and also how long the employee has been in his or her position. Okay, how to use those three criteria, you know, we'll get to in a minute. So with the proposed plan, the next step really would be to establish a consistent way to pay employees, and we'll talk about that in a minute as well. And then at the same time, develop final drafts. You don't really have union. All the job descriptions need to be finalized, which really means once you've approved the classification plan, you are in effect as a Board of Selectmen approving the job descriptions. I just want to reiterate, as I've said to many of the employees, the Board of Selectmen approves job descriptions, not employees. You're the only one that approves the job description. The employees will tell you whether they feel it's accurate or not, but that's not really approving the job description. And then in approving the salary plan or the salary ranges, what I'm suggesting is that you need to establish what I call a hiring range a market equity range and a growth range, which again we'll get to in a minute. So let me just take you back to the beginning, and I mentioned we're recommending six grade levels. The easiest way for you to understand what each of the six grade levels means is to look at what I call a characteristic chart. And all you see here are the outline, the summary of what are the key characteristics that define each of the grade levels. So before we put positions into a grade level, the first thing we really had to do was to define the levels of responsibility, basically, that exist within this organization. So for example, if you look at grade level one, and all I've done is bolded what I think is the key characteristic, the most important characteristic that defines each grade level. So you see right in the middle of the characteristics for grade level one, the phrase direct supervision. And right over to the side of it, direct supervision means the job duties are clear, detailed, specific instructions govern the work. So a position in grade level one, when you look at the job duties in the job description, they'd be very specific, very clear, repetitive, redundant types of job duties that really correlate to basically an entry level or the lowest level of responsibility. Mm-hmm. The next grade level, you see the phrase general supervision. Unlike direct supervision, general supervision means anything unusual out of the ordinary, you're expected to check with your supervisor before you proceed. But what you would see when you look at the job duties of a position in grade level two is a much broader range, wider range of responsibility. Not just everything repetitive, redundant, you do a lot of different things. The key aspect of what you do, though, is everything you do is governed by an established rule, regulation, law, or policy. So if you're asked to do something in terms of defining the level of responsibility in grade level two that is not governed by a law, it's not governed by a policy, that's already in place, then as this definition indicates, you would be expected to check with your supervisor before proceeding ahead to carry out that job duty. So a little bit more responsibility than grade level one. Grade level one, again, the job duties, very clear, specific, repetitive, redundant types of responsibilities, very little independence. Grade level two, a little bit more independence, because you're doing a wider range of things, you have a wider range of responsibility, but everything you're doing is being governed by established rule or regulation.
I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
It's a term I don't know exactly what it means, the non-exempt position. I don't know what that means.
Yeah, that's a good point. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to jump over it. Non-exempt means that you're eligible for overtime in accordance with the Fair Labor Standards Act.
Okay.
That is how we write the job description. When you see the format at the top, the header of every job description will have a box at the top that'll say FLSA, which stands for the Fair Labor Standards Act. And the box will be filled in to say either exempt or non-exempt. So if it says exempt, that means that you're not eligible for overtime. If it's non-exempt, you are eligible.
Okay.
So basically, one of the purposes of the job, and I know that's a little bit confusing, it almost sounds like it's backwards.
It does sound like it's backwards.
Yeah, that's a federal law. What do you expect? Not to get political.
Yeah.
But the fact is that writing the job description, one of the purposes of writing the job description is to determine whether or not an employee in that job should or should not be paid overtime based on how the job description is written. Mm-hmm. So the Fair Labor Standards Act, which I provide a copy or the outline of the criteria in my final report to you, is the basis by which any position, public or private, is determined to be eligible for overtime or not. So as you can see, the grade level one and grade level two, what they share in common is none of the positions in the first two grade levels, they're all eligible for overtime. None of them are exempt,
okay,
based on the level of responsibility.
Okay.
When you look at grade level three, you see the same non-exempt again. So grade level one, two, and three, all eligible for overtime, right? Where they differ is their level of responsibility. Mm-hmm. And you see the phrase now in grade level three, general direction, as opposed to general supervision.
Mm-hmm.
So general direction means, as it says here, anything unusual out of the ordinary, meaning that's not necessarily governed by a rule, a regulation, or a policy, you are expected to try to carry out the job duty. So you have more responsibility, a higher level of accountability, okay, than you would in a position at grade level one or grade level two. But nonetheless, you still would be eligible for overtime. Okay, so what I'm trying to share with you by showing you these characteristics, even if you go back and look at the characteristics for grade levels one and two, your education and experience, one of the misunderstandings about job descriptions is people tend to think that education, the minimum education, minimum experience, is, they feel, the most important part of the job description. In reality, it's just the opposite. It's not the most important part of the job description. What really drives the standard for education and or minimum experience is the level of responsibility. So the higher the level of responsibility, as we go up through these grade levels, what you're seeing is a corresponding increase in the minimum knowledge level or the minimum number of years of experience. So grade level one, if you look, go back and look at it, it says high school diploma or 1 year of experience. Grade level two, associate's degree, 1 to 3 years experience. Grade level three says bachelor's degree. Now, it doesn't mean an individual in any of these grade levels couldn't have greater than and or less than years of experience and or knowledge level, because we're not talking about the employee here. We're not talking about the person in terms of who's most qualified or who you've determined to hire. We're talking about the position here and only the position. So we're setting standards for positions, not for employees. Okay? Mm-hmm. Grade level four, you see the same general direction, but if you notice the last bullet, it says work leader level of supervisory responsibility. So for the first time, the first three grade levels, no supervisory responsibility. Grade level four, on the other hand, you'll see positions that or people that may be required to provide direction and guidance.
Just like a foreman or something position?
Exactly. I mean, required to give direction and guidance, but not necessarily take disciplinary action, not to necessarily hold people accountable. A work leader basically gives instruction, gives guidance, may help train people, but doesn't necessarily hold them accountable. We'll get to that higher level of supervisory responsibility in the following grade level. So grades 1, 2, 3, and 4, no supervisory responsibility until you get to grade level 4, and basically a higher level of accountability or responsibility in grade level 4 than the first three grade levels. Grade level 5, you see the phrase administrative direction, not general direction. In our terminology, administrative direction basically means you're responsible for the performance of a function or a town department. So you're not just responsible for what you do individually, but you're also responsible for the employees, if there are other employees within the department. But basically, you're responsible for that department, how the department functions, in addition to the employees. Hence, you see then the level of supervisory responsibility is at a level we describe as a managerial level of supervisory responsibility. And that's where you see exempt position for the first time.
It's like a salaried position.
Well, you can be like salaried, but still be paid overtime. That's one of the misunderstandings, one of the confusing things about overtime. You can still be salaried. It's a question of how much the salary is relative to being exempt or non-exempt from overtime.
Okay.
What exempts an employee in grade level 5 is not the salary, or the salary has to be above the minimum federal weekly earning level. It's really the level of responsibility. Because here you're administering, you're accountable. Administering in this context really means you're required to plan what to do, how to do it, how to assign staff, how to estimate the cost of doing something, how to what equipment needs to be bought. A simple way to explain it is you're required to plan.
Mm-hmm.
And by definition, then, you're exempt from overtime. Now, there is an exception to that, not to get off track, but if it's relating to public safety, then the Fair Labor Standards Act allows you to pay, even though I may be the fire chief required to manage, plan for the fire department. There are provisions in the Fair Labor Standards Act to recognize public safety as an unusual situation involving, obviously, public safety types of issues, and you therefore can pay them overtime.
Hmm. Okay.
Right? You have that prerogative. It's up to you. Grade level 6, you see the same managerial level of supervisory responsibility, but you see the word major department. So the word major in our rating system really basically means the most complex departments. It could be that you're responsible for more than one functional area, i.e. if I'm a fire chief and I'm responsible for not just fire suppression, but although not the case here in Conway, you might be responsible for emergency medical services, not necessarily EMS, ambulance service, but you certainly provide emergency medical response services and or fire prevention or emergency management types of things, or the police chief might have other responsibilities other than just being the most complex department, meaning 24/7, 365 days a year type of thing. So what we basically are trying to say is that you can have two positions that have managerial level of responsibility, but one's more complex than the other.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And that's how we wind up with 6 grade levels. So the next chart just shows you how we're recommending the regular position is to be assigned to one of those six grade levels. So if you want to know why a position is recommended to be at one grade level and not another, very simply, all you have to do is look at the characteristic chart. If for no other reason, then that'll give you enough of a guideline to tell you the different levels of responsibility for each of the six grade levels. So you notice everything I've been sharing with you at this point, nothing has anything to do with dollars and cents. So what's really driving the development of the grade levels is not the market data. It's not dollars and cents. It's establishing the level of responsibility within this organization. So essentially, the six levels of responsibility are consistent with the six levels of responsibility if you were to draw an organizational chart of the entire town of Conway. So your classification plan needs to match your organizational plan. So as you add positions, as you change positions, you may reorganize the department at some point. Your classification plan needs to respond to that. So whenever there's a management change with respect to how you assign responsibility to a position, if it's a significant change, well, the word significant now is defined by how positions have been rated. So significant now is not an open-ended, or it's not a term that's not defined, just the opposite. It now is defined. And so by evaluating the position, by applying the rating system, you are in effect determining whether or not a change in responsibility, or how, let's say, a new position's responsibilities are established and how those responsibilities compare to all the other positions that already exist within the town. And so as a result, from a classification standpoint, the rating system forces you, requires you to do it in a consistent way. Or another way to say that is how you treat one position, the rating system requires you to treat every other position exactly the same way. Mm-hmm. Doesn't mean they get rated the same. Because you might determine, and as I'm sure you will, we've determined that there's six levels of responsibility. You could at some point determine maybe there's more levels of responsibility. Right now, I think six levels, again, the check and balance is your organizational structure. So basically, if you stop and think about it, you've got a group of major department heads, both being managers, but one more complex than the other. Then you've got a level of position right below a department head that we refer to as general direction. And then you've got three other levels below that that are basically different levels of responsibility, all of them exempt from overtime. Okay, so really the first four levels, grade levels, all the positions in those four levels are exempt from overtime.
Are non-exempt.
They're non-exempt, no, which means they're not eligible for overtime.
Right. They are exempt.
Right.
They are exempt.
They are what? Say it again.
They're non-exempt.
They're non-exempt, therefore they are eligible.
They are eligible for overtime. You said not correct. Eligible.
Yeah, they so are eligible. Yeah. I'm getting twisted up.
Twisted up.
So now what I'd like to briefly talk to you about now is the dollars and cents. So based on six grade levels, we then wanted to use the market data that we've collected from the 10 communities that we surveyed to help us develop a benchmark, and then from the benchmark, the salary range minimum and salary range maximum. So the next chart that I want to just draw your attention to is, I don't know if you have it, it's called proposed salary range, the survey data.
Oh, that's the next one down.
Yeah.
This one?
Yeah, I'd rather go to this one first and then we'll come back to the
survey data, okay.
So the top of the page says proposed salary range to fiscal 2016 survey data. And the reason why I like to start by showing you this chart is that this shows you really everything you need to know with respect to how we're recommending ranges to be developed. So right in the middle of the chart, you see the fiscal 16 survey average minimum, midpoint, and maximum. And you see the data that we've collected. So for example, in the custodian position, and for the sake of simplicity or compare apples to apples, I've converted everything to an hourly rate of pay, just so that we can compare one position to another and not be concerned about how many hours someone may work per week or what have you. So the custodian position, you see we collected survey data where the average survey minimum was $12.03 and the maximum was $14.66. And the midpoint was $13.35. So if you want to know, well, where did that data come from, all you need to do is take a look at the salary survey charts that are in your packet. Okay, so what's behind these survey numbers is the actual survey data. Okay, and the survey data is organized so there's a summary sheet And then there's a detailed chart behind that that tells you exactly which communities responded for which positions. All right, so all 10 communities are broken down individually by position, and they're summarized on the front. So what you see here on this proposed salary range, the survey data chart, is the summary, is the overall result of the data we collected. So as I mentioned earlier, in developing a benchmark, we took the survey average midpoint data for each grade level. So if you look at grade level one for the custodian, the laborer, and the transfer station attendant, we took the survey average midpoint data you see right in the middle of the chart, add that up and divide by three, and you get a proposed benchmark of $15.26. All right, so if you go over to the left, you see the proposed range benchmark column. That number, and the reason why it's an odd number, is because it's an average of the market data we've collected. All right, and remember, the benchmark is a guide. No one automatically gets paid $15.26. We're using that benchmark to help us define the word competitive. And as I said earlier, once we'd established a benchmark, we took a percentage of the benchmark to be the minimum, and then we multiplied the minimum by a percentage to give us a maximum. Now, when these numbers that you see in front of you, the $12.21 and the $19.53, are actually, the minimum is 80% of the benchmark. So if you multiply $15.26 times 0.80, you get $12.21. And again, just keep in mind, no one automatically gets paid any of these numbers. They're there strictly to help us define the word competitive. And then if you multiply 1221 by 60%, you get $19.53. So these are just guide numbers. I'm just sharing with you the process, the so-called formula that I followed in putting a range together, minimum, benchmark, and maximum, that I then, remember I said there's three checks and balances. The first one is market data. So if you have a range of 1221 up to 1953, well, how does that compare to the market data? The percentages that you see on the right-hand side of the chart. So for example, for the custodian, $12.21 is about 1.45% greater, right? Whereas a benchmark of $15.26 is about 12.5% greater than $13.35, right? Just as the maximum of 1953 is almost 25% greater than the survey average maximum of $14.66. Okay? And we do it the same way for every single position. So I'm able to say to you tonight that if you establish a range of 1221 to 1953, in my opinion, that's competitive with the market data that we collected for this current fiscal year. And I'm not, hypothetical. In other words, that maximum column for the percentages is very, very important to determine that the range is wide enough that it's competitive with the market data today. Okay? The second check and balance is the salary of the employee. So let's go back and look at the custodian. His current salary is $14.19. And if you go back to the right-hand column side of the chart, I'm comparing that $14.19 to the proposed benchmark of $15.26. Mm-hmm. And it's roughly about 7.5% lower. Mm-hmm. And he's been in the position 14 years. So the third check and balance is how long someone's been in their position. Okay? So the rule of thumb or policy is that if you've been in your position at least 3 to 5 years, no matter what position we're talking about, you should be paid competitively with the marketplace. That's a pretty standard policy to follow, which if you really stop and think about it, I think makes common sense. You hire a brand new employee, if you're not paying them competitively within a reasonable period of time, and I'm suggesting reasonable is generally somewhere between 3 years and 5 years, doesn't mean you have to pay them competitively, but the purpose of this exercise was to make sure you understand, just like the employee should understand, whether in fact they're being paid competitively or not, both internally as well as externally. All right. And so when you go to grade level two, it's the same process. You look at the survey data we collected for the clerk position, the assistant treasurer collector, and the labor equipment operator, add those three numbers up, the midpoint numbers, and these are average numbers. And divide by three, you get $19.53 as a benchmark for grade level two. Grade level three, there's only one position in grade level three, again, we used the average midpoint of the data to be the benchmark, and we took the same percentage of the benchmark to be the minimum and multiplied the minimum by a percentage to be the maximum. Again, just as guides to help us develop a range that's wide enough. So essentially, what this all results in is a range structure that's easy for you to maintain. So every year you should do a survey of the marketplace. It doesn't mean you have to survey every single position. You should do what I call a benchmark survey. You select randomly a handful of positions just to get enough of a sense of what's going on in the marketplace. And then look at that new data you collect, which is only going to have the net effect of changing your benchmark number, right? And then that in turn allows you then to compare what already exists as a minimum and a maximum. So if you're going to make an adjustment to the range structure, let the marketplace tell you how much of an adjustment it should be. What you shouldn't do, unfortunately a lot of municipalities do this, is you shouldn't just come up with a, say, a 2% across the board salary adjustment and then the whole structure goes up by 2%. That shouldn't happen here. If you're going to change your ranges, let the marketplace tell you when in fact it's time to change your range, and if so, by how much. So you're always adjusting by dollar amounts, not by percentages. One of the other common mistakes that I see municipalities make all the time is when they think about compensation, they're always thinking about percentages. And we're going to approve a 2% across the board increase, and we're going to adjust our ranges by 2%. And when I always say, well, why 2%? Isn't it really a dollar amount you're adjusting your ranges by? And how does that dollar amount compare to the market data? Maybe you don't need to change your range this year. Or maybe you change one range but not the other. Because the market data doesn't always go up the same amount. It depends on the position. So again, everything that I'm sharing with you tonight, and I know this is getting a little bit long-winded to say the least, I'm going to provide to you in writing. So you'll have a set of written guidelines that'll basically reiterate everything that I'm sharing with you this evening. But again, each range that you see in front of you on this chart has been developed exactly the same way, same process. But I want to make sure you understand, you have the flexibility. If you look at this chart and you feel that $12.21 is not a competitive number, well, you have the flexibility to change it anytime you want to, right? Mm-hmm. Just as when you collect new market data, you might change your ranges, or you might not. So from one year to the next, or from one period of time to another period of time, it's really up to the board to decide, you know, do you want to make an adjustment to the marketplace or don't you? You know, should you or shouldn't you? But at least now you'll be working with hard numbers, real numbers, not made up. So you'll be able to explain, remember, one of the objectives from the get-go was to be able to explain to the employees, where do these numbers come from? What do they mean? And obviously I'm sharing you in a very long-winded way what they mean. If you look at the next chart, which is the proposed hiring range, market equity, and growth range, these are the same numbers you saw on the previous chart. So the benchmark number of $15.26, if you go back and look at the other chart, you can see where it came from. Mm-hmm. Okay? And the 1221 and the 1953, again, those are the same numbers. What I am suggesting now, and now we're talking about paying the employee. So up until now, everything I've been basically sharing with you has been about paying the position and how to develop a salary range that's competitive with market data. Okay? And hopefully you get a sense when you look at the six grade levels. What's always interesting to me is when I finally put the market data down on paper, and I'm not making the market data up,
right,
the benchmarks seem to go up consistent with the grade levels. So the higher the level of responsibility, the higher the salary number. How much is based on market data? It's not some fixed percentage, like, you know, those percentages, those benchmarks have not been adjusted by 10% or 8%, or they vary all over the place because the market data varies all over the place. So what's really driving this process is dollars and cents, not percentages. Some places I've worked with prefer to use a formula. They prefer to use percentages. So if we're going to establish a benchmark, well, then each benchmark should go up by a certain percent. I prefer to let the market tell me what that new number, what that other benchmark number should be. So we're not playing around with those numbers at all. It's strictly market driven. So what I'm showing you on this other chart is, in hiring an employee, there's three components to compensation as it relates to paying an employee. First one obviously pertains to hiring a new employee. And the second component pertains to retaining the employee. And the third one relates specifically to paying an employee more money. So what I'm suggesting be established is within each salary range, you in effect establish a hiring range, what I call a market equity range, and then lastly, what I just label or call a growth range. So what this really means in practical terms is that if you want to go to hire a new employee, let's say in grade level one, and as I mentioned earlier, the custodian position is recommended to be classified in grade level one. So if you're going to hire a new custodian tomorrow, what this is saying, if these numbers are competitive, is you should be able to hire a new custodian or maybe a new laborer somewhere between a minimum and a maximum range that I'm referring to as a hiring range. So here, all I've done is taken the minimum and the benchmark and literally divided it by two, just to keep it simple. So that $13.73 is literally halfway between those two numbers. Mm-hmm. And all I'm saying is, let's then call a hiring range somewhere between 1221 and 1373. You should be able to hire a new employee, new custodian, let's say, somewhere between those numbers, 1221 to 1373. And the reason why I'm comfortable with it, if you go back and look at the previous chart, if you compare 1221 to 1373 to the market data for the custodian that we collected, well, the average midpoint was 1335. Mm-hmm. That's the midpoint, and that's an average number, right? Mm-hmm. So if you have a minimum maximum hiring range of 1221 to 1373, I know you're competitive with the market data. Mm-hmm. So for someone that meets the minimum qualifications, you should be able to hire a new employee somewhere within that hiring range. So what I'm suggesting, again, is what you shouldn't do is when you look at these ranges, remember, flexibility is really, I think, the key, is to give you the flexibility to negotiate with the employee you want to hire within a range, not a fixed number. So under this type of plan, no one gets paid automatically, as I said earlier, that minimum number, step one, you know, that so many towns do. When you ask them, well, why do you hire somebody at step one? I don't know. That's just where we start. Well, you don't even know if it's competitive or not. And so all I'm suggesting is to give you, the board, the hiring authority, the flexibility to hire a new employee is why I like the concept of establishing a hiring range. Now, the policy that I would recommend to you, and again, when I say what I'll recommend, it will be in the final report, the policy with respect to hiring a new employee will basically say it's the policy of the town of Conway to hire new employees within the hiring range with the understanding, remember, flexibility is the key, that the Board of Selectmen has the right, or the appointing authority has the flexibility or the right, to hire above the hiring range based on market conditions and or qualifications of the employee. So you're never constrained, you're never restricted, your hands aren't tied. You get to decide what you think is the appropriate salary for a new employee based on their qualifications and or based on market conditions, and of course, last but not least, based on what you can afford.
Yeah.
Can't leave lose sight of that.
Yeah.
But by establishing a market equity range, really all I'm saying is that there should be some range above or below the benchmark. And again, that benchmark number we know is a market-driven number. It's a real number. It's the only real number that's on this chart. Mm-hmm. And just like with regard to the hiring range, well, there should be a range that I think you basically can use to define the word competitive. Okay? So if an employee is paid anywhere between $13.73 and $17.40, that $17.40, again, is halfway between the benchmark and the maximum. Right? And I'm just sharing with you how I came up with these numbers. Mm-hmm. So anyone that's paid anywhere between those two numbers, above or below the benchmark by a certain dollar amount, is being paid competitively. So unlike the chart that I showed you before when I took the salary and compared it specifically to the benchmark number, I wanted you to see whether someone today is above or below the benchmark, but the real question I'm suggesting to give you the flexibility and also to minimize the cost effect is the other chart that I'll give you will show the current employee and whether they're above or below the range for the market equity. So it isn't just the benchmark number. It's the minimum and the maximum of the benchmark, or excuse me, of the market equity range. Okay? And the growth range is just basically to say, look, when you grow within the range, you don't have to be paid competitively to reach the top of the range. Unlike a lot of other plans that I've seen, where you max out after a defined period of time, under this plan, you don't max out. You control how quickly people grow within the range, based on what you can afford. Now, what I'm suggesting as a policy is that the higher up in the range you grow, whether you're above or below that market range, market equity range, really should determine how much of an increase you receive. So the higher up in the range, the more competitively you're being paid, the less of an increase, because you're being paid more competitively. So when you hire a brand new employee, let's say within that hiring range, what I'm suggesting is the amount of salary adjustment they would receive would be greater than somebody whose salary is above the market equity range. The good news is they all grow, and they grow by a dollar amount, not by a percentage. So again, that's another change that I'm recommending, is that when you think about paying an employee more money, what I'm suggesting to you is you should think of it as a dollars and cent number. In other words, the overall objective, getting back to where we started from, is to pay employees competitively. Well, that competitive, we've now defined a number, and the number is the benchmark, or it's the range between a minimum and a maximum of the market equity range. But they're hard numbers, they're real numbers, they're not percentages. So when you pay an employee money for salary purposes to pay them competitively, all I'm suggesting is the amount of money you pay them is based on what you can afford. Once you make the determination as to what you can afford, again, I know I said this when we at the beginning, the real question is how do you spend that money? And that's ultimately the real challenge that every employer faces, is how to spend the money relative to paying an employee, always based on what you can afford. And all I'm suggesting is that employees shouldn't get the same dollar increase. Some may get some similar, but some may get more, some may get less. Whether you're paid less than or more than someone else, the key is to be able to explain it. And as long as you can explain it, that's why the benchmark becomes such a useful tool or a guide for you to use. So even with municipalities that don't even want to get into hiring ranges and equity ranges and all that, very simply, if you're above or below the benchmark, that'll determine how much of an increase you get. How much? Well, it's based on what you can afford. And that's basically the plan. I mean, it's not meant to be any more difficult than it really should be, and that is, you know, in order to do this consistently, the classification process is driven by the rating system. The compensation process is really driven by the market data. And once you put employees into the plan, and I know Tom in his proposed budget, he'll get to it, I guess, when he presents the budget later this evening, he's factored that into his decision-making relative to how much to appropriate and then how to spend the money, okay? And so that going forward, you don't see any steps here. And again, in a lot of compensation plans, you'll look at, you just have to look at some of your neighbors and you'll see step plans all over the place. I don't believe in step plans, personally. You don't have to have steps. I look at steps as tying your hands. It's restrictive. It's expensive. And one fiscal year to the next, you may not be able to afford a step increase. If I had a nickel for every town I've worked with that has step plans, and all of a sudden they can't afford the step increase, and therefore we don't give it to everybody. Well, what's the point of even having it on a paper if you're not going to do it? Well, I think the real problem is why restrict yourself by putting what are really artificial steps down on a piece of paper? You, in effect, what I recommend to Tom to do is, based on everyone's current salary, particularly employees that are below the market range, market equity range, based on what you can afford, develop a compensation plan, which is the same thing as saying steps. So within X number of years, subject to appropriation, our objective is to pay you competitively. So when you hire that new employee and you start them in the hiring range, then within a defined period of time, subject to appropriation, our objective is to pay you competitively. And we can tell you how long it's going to take based on what we can afford. So from one fiscal year to the next, and we're going to weight the amount of increase that you receive, so we're going to try to get you up to the competitive range as quickly as we can based on what we can afford. And I think, you know, with this type of system in place, I think it's easy to maintain. You should be able to maintain it yourself. You do a periodic salary survey. Tom and I have gone through the rating system. He understands it relative to, you know, a new position or to change a current position and determine whether or not that change is significant or not. All that's determined by how the position is, quote unquote, evaluated or rated. And that's done by the rating system. And the rating manual, by the way, that's in the final report, becomes a public document. And I've said to employees right from the get-go, the better they understand how this system works, the better the system's going to work. There's no reason I can think of why I wouldn't want them to understand it.
Go back to the communication part you said at the beginning.
Exactly. So when it's all said and done, and again, I'll just give you a handout just to help you if you didn't have enough paper as it is. This just simply defines hiring, market equity, and growth. And then just as an example of a policy,
thank you.
So that just puts in writing what I've, you know, tried to explain to you. So essentially,
I'm glad you did that.
You'll wind up with, as I said, a set of administrative policies. This is only one part of it. The other part of the policies will cover everything from writing job descriptions to doing the salary survey, developing the salary ranges, and so forth. And if you don't already, and I know I've met with your personnel board a couple of times, and you've got a good group of people on the personnel board, very knowledgeable, very experienced.
Yeah,
and I think they're very comfortable with the process. You know, I've heard several people say to me, oh, this sounds like a private sector compensation system. Yeah, I don't know what they mean by that. I mean, to me, it's a fair way. It's a consistent way. And the difference with the private sector is the private sector doesn't have to tell you how they do it, whereas we do. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes this more difficult. And so if it's consistent with, as I said, your values with respect to how you want to treat your employees, remember, I began by saying to you, your employees need to hear from you, which means I can't encourage you enough. You can always make adjustments to these numbers. It's the process that I'm really asking you tonight to approve. Mm-hmm. The numbers can be whatever you want them to be, and I'm happy to work with you to change them or adjust them. Or I'm also happy to work with Tom, although I think he's got a good handle on the cost aspect of this relative to the employee compensation part of it. But it's the process to develop the grade levels, to develop the salary ranges, that is really critically important for you to approve. Mm-hmm. So when you get the policy document, I would encourage you as a board to approve them and treat them like you would any other Board of Selectmen policy. It's always subject to you being able to change them whenever you feel you need to.
Mm-hmm. And your final report's going to be to us when, Don?
You'll have it next week.
Okay.
Unless I get a crisis call from Tom between now and the end of the week. The only reason I didn't bring a final report. I almost did, but I thought, well, you know, that would be a little bit, I don't know what the word is, presumptuous on my part.
But this keeps it flexible.
But I really want to give you the time or the opportunity for you to sit back and really decide whether or not you're comfortable with the process the way we've laid it out for you. Mm-hmm. So the process, again, covers everything from how we surveyed the marketplace, how we used the market data to develop the ranges, and of course, starting with how we developed the six grade levels as well.
Right. Yeah, very, very comprehensive, Tom.
Yeah.
Very comprehensive.
Very good.
Well, I appreciate that. And again, hopefully it's simple enough that, again, by putting it in writing, whenever there's turnover, new employees, new board members, new whomever, you'll have a written document you can give them that'll explain to them, here's how we will treat you as an employee of the town of Conway. Trust me when I tell you, you'll be the only one in the area that's doing it, other than Shelburne.
Oh. Shelburne's here the same place.
Well,
yeah. We're having to do some work.
Pleased that you're here explaining it, because I've looked over what you've given Tom to give to us, and I'm not very good at this sort of thing, so it's good to help me understand it.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Really,
we'll digest this over the next week. We'll get your report, and we'll go from there.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Mr. Chair.
Yeah,
and again, I can't encourage you enough to take the time you need, but all you need to act.
Don, thank you much.
Thank you, sir. Pleasure.
Thanks,
nice meeting again.
Thank you, Don.
Appreciate
it.
See you.
Thanks very much.
I look forward to hearing you that I can put the final report together.
Yeah.
You know, just before I leave, you know, the stipend positions, and I know you have concerns with regard to the fire department and ambulance and so forth. I think right from the get-go, I recommended to Tom that we put them in a separate group, only because if nothing else, that's the way the market unfortunately treats smaller departments like you have.
Yeah.
I find that market data to be very, very unreliable. You know, particularly when you see fixed amounts of money.
Sure. Yeah.
I would encourage you as best you can. And I'm dealing with this with a couple other smaller towns like Phillipston right now, where you know, they've got a group of positions that are paid a stipend amount of money, and there's no rationale for that dollar amount at all.
None.
Just a number.
There never is.
Never is. Rarely have I ever seen it. Yep. And, you know, that should give you, that should be a heads up right there. And if you're comfortable with that type of compensation process, fine. But if it's a position that you really count on, you know, where you really need that person in that position to provide the service that you expect, which means put the hours in or put the time in to do it, paying them a fixed amount of money is a hard way to do it.
Yep, it is.
So if you can convert them to an hourly rate of pay, at least then you've got a consistent way to do it, as opposed to a fixed amount of money. So, again, if I can help you in that regard, a lot of the smaller towns face the same problem.
Yeah.
So,
thanks.
All right, thank you. I'm sorry to run on.
Yep. See you.
Take care.
Appreciate your time.
Safe home.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. Go grab Meg.
Yeah.
Hey, Meg.
Hi,
Meg.
How are we doing?
I'm all right, thanks. How are you?
Good.
Well, I'll restate my last little sentence thing. I hope you had a good vacation.
I did.
How are you, Joe?
Hello, gentlemen.
I'm Joseph.
How are you? I went south of Mason-Dixon.
Yeah, you said it's dangerous down there. You got to watch out. I know those people.
I had a little trouble getting home, but...
I know them people. I know them people.
Them people.
Yeah. Do you have an update for us, Meg?
I do have just... I'll be as brief as I can. So
good.
There are the DPU filings. 1601 and 1603 are the two that pertain to Conway. There is a 1602, which has to do with vernal pools, and they do not name Conway in that document.
That's 16-01?
Yep.
16-03.
Yes.
And these first pages in your handout are all from 16-01.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So 16-01 is Kinder Morgan's petition to DPU for eminent domain for the purpose of geotechnical drilling for their sampling.
Okay.
There are two private landowners in Conway who are named, and then TransCanada is also named for their property.
Right.
Okay. So those three properties have denied access. Within both, the other 16-03 is for essentially all other surveys that have been denied, and there are six parcels of six landowners in Conway who have denied parcels of land within Conway. I think the six is within Conway.
All residents denied access.
What's that?
Any of our residents allowed access, or they all denied?
I assume everybody else has.
As far as I know, the Sportsman's Club is the only access permitted. No, that's not true.
It says the 03 from the on it. These are the ones.
These are
everyone else has granted permission?
Yes, but there aren't that many.
I don't know what the total is.
Yeah. These are the ones.
So there's six here and three on the other. There's nine that have denied, I guess.
Nine have denied.
I don't remember how many we had.
At one point we had 12, but then when the route changed, I think one was no longer impacted. It went across Eversource property, that small piece of Eversource property off Shelburne Falls Road. So within these reports, they're asking for the eminent domain. There's also five or six pages discussing the Deerfield Board of Health and the Conway Board of Health's actions. And
what you have is pages 16 through 21.
Right. What's interesting is they note that these efforts are futile. They list all kinds of legal challenges that they could make. When you go to the end of that filing, when they're asking for the specific response from the DPU, they don't mention the Board of Health of Deerfield or the Board of Health of Conway. So contrary to what, when you read this, you kind of think, oh, they're asking for something to be done. Mm-hmm. If they're asking for that, I haven't been able to find it in their language. It's not specifically
that. One of the things that bothers me is it doesn't matter what you think, we can get permission to do it.
That's their
basically.
That's their position.
Yeah, that's Kinder Morgan's position.
That's Kinder Morgan's position.
I also read into it. They're trying to put the blinders on DPU and saying you can only discuss the eminent domain. This is not about where the pipeline goes. That's outside of your jurisdiction. You're only here to tell us whether we can have
take everybody's land that says we can.
Right. And they're essentially trying to basically steamroll the process. And get eminent domain before they have the certificate.
Just a point. On the page you have, it's page 23. It's after the 16 to 21. I think that's where they are tacitly saying overturn the Boards of Health order by saying that we want you to authorize us to travel across these properties to conduct surveys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they are, in that sense.
In that sense, right.
They're asking the DPU to overturn the orders.
How does that work? If they grant permission and you appeal it, do they get to go anyway?
Yes, they get to go ahead while the appeal
while
is
appeals in process.
They can go ahead to work while the appeal's in process?
Yes.
Wow. That doesn't sound right. Well, one of the interesting
things... I heard
that
before.
There's a lot that doesn't sound right in this process.
By the time you get finished the appeal, the surveys have already been done.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And then maybe there's a fine or some kind of remediation that has to be done.
It's the same way with the taking of the value. They go ahead and do the work, and then you argue about what you're going to get paid.
Well, one of the interesting things, and I mentioned this before the meeting started, I'll mention it again, it's about who owns Berks Gas, and it's an international Spain-based company, and they have bought Berkshire Gas and other related pieces of business for $3 billion, and they plan to give Kinder Morgan $80 million to help put through this pipeline. We're talking really big money that they're throwing out there to get their way.
Yes.
And that really bothers me, you know, in terms of who we are as a nation. And it's sort of like the King of England and his guys who were bullying the colonies. Mm-hmm. And now we've got big international corporations who are bullying all the people who are in their way. And I just denounce that kind of attitude.
Meg, do you have anything?
The other, I just had two sort of small other points. One is in terms of there is a hearing on March 30th in Greenfield.
Oh yeah.
Where is that going to be held?
I believe it's at the Greenfield Middle School. At this point don't. It's unclear to me whether there would be a comment directly from a town board, other than perhaps the Board of Health, and that needs to be discussed. It's yet to be discussed. These documents are yet to be discussed at the Board of Health meeting.
Just so you know, the documents we're talking about, this is the DPU 16-01,
right.
And this is the GPU. It's mostly maps.
Mostly maps.
Yes.
But the documents are starting to come in,
as
we expected.
And I think, I think one thing that we need to consider, and I don't have a recommendation on this, but to think about how, as a town, various committees may offer support or any guidance to the impacted landowners.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think that for some folks that are named in these, it's a big deal for
mm-hmm.
sure. And I know one of the properties, interesting, in the DPU-01, the 16-01, they specifically say that no drilling will be done within 75 feet of a well or a structure. When I print out the map from Kinder Morgan's filing in November 20th filing, one of the impacted properties, I'm not sure that you can go from the property line to the house and be beyond 75 feet. There's just not that much space. So, and I don't have on this where the well is.
That's
so.
The one on Bridge Fair Road?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure how they're gonna do any drilling.
Oh, the one that goes under the house?
That the drilling
the well
would essentially go under
right,
the house
under,
and the well.
Yeah, under
if,
the well.
If the proposed pipeline was built.
Yeah.
I heard through the grapevine that he has proposed trying to get the pipeline company, the Tennessee Gas, to buy his property?
They haven't responded to that.
Yeah, he mentioned that at the meeting. So. I don't know if you were there. No. Yeah. He made.
He was almost in tears.
Oh, God, it's going to,
he's going to run his place.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It will, yeah.
He won't get 50 cents on
it.
He won't get 10 cents on a dollar after.
Yeah, right.
So that's really a brief update. I mean, I think the Board of Health will meet again in or second Monday of March. And I've asked that this be put on the agenda there in terms of any response that the board might make to the filing. And I don't know, I was going to find out what, if any, response the Deerfield Board of Health was going to make. Mm-hmm.
Great.
Preparation.
The planning board discussed, and we can't think of a response to make other than all the same complaints that we've done before, so we probably won't do anything at this point.
Okay.
Unless we could agree as a group that there's something we should do.
I think it's worth considering, to continuing to consider what we might, how we might respond.
Unfortunately, don't you think a lot of this is out of our hands now?
Probably, yeah.
It was interesting, a lot of what they're proposing to do is what we put in our new bylaw. But we didn't expect it would happen in my domain. But yeah. I mean, the things that they're talking about doing are things that we're saying you should do for a major project going to our town. But, yeah. You know, the geotechnical stuff and you know, all this mapping are all things that we've asked for in the bylaw. But
I've
never thought about it happening under forceful conditions, I guess.
Yeah.
It's, it'll be, it continues to be interesting.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Meg.
You're welcome.
Appreciate you coming in.
Absolutely. Thank you for
your
time.
Thank you, Joe.
Yeah, I'm staying.
I know you're staying. Just want to thank you for this part.
Thank you for hanging out.
Tom, are you next with...
Yes. Okay. I just have a few things that I've been encouraged to put on the... as placeholders for the annual town meeting warrant. One is a wastewater article, which we're going to hear about from Joe.
Okay.
Also, the youth sports revolving account that was tabled last year, I think Parks and Rec is ready to move forward with that. Also, there was a question that came up internally that I'd like the board to kick around a little bit, which is that although in the bylaws it says that no one but Conway residents can be elected to Conway positions, it doesn't say that Conway residents can't be appointed to Conway committees. Non-Conway residents can't be appointed to Conway committees. So the board might want to consider a policy or a bylaw that said, you know, unless you're a Conway resident, you can't be on a Conway committee. Maybe unless you get special dispensation from the select board, or you can leave yourselves an out or something like that if you want. But it seems odd that we did not say the same thing for committees as we did for elected officials. Yeah, so you might, if you guys could discuss that.
That's always been our practice.
Yeah, and so I'll put, you know, it'll be there and you can discuss it, you know.
We'll do that.
As part of the warrant discussion.
Anything else?
Nothing on the town meeting warrant.
Danny, nice.
Hi.
Thanks for coming in. Jack.
Thanks.
Hi, how are you? Jack on fire? Careful.
It's a radiator thing?
Yeah. Okay, we have the housing committee.
This is the wastewater.
We're wastewater.
No housing committee tonight.
Not
apparently.
I thought they were coming in too.
Yeah.
Well, all right, we'll just, if they're not here, we'll just go over them for right now. Wastewater. Wastewater.
Wastewater.
What's your
Sewer rats. Okay. Research on alternate technologies.
Okay. Yeah. How long did it take to come up with that name?
I don't know. It just sort of popped into our heads.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Anyway, speaking of technology, we're moving ahead at times at a snail's pace and other times a little fast. Right now, we're looking at putting a leaching field, what I would call a community leaching field, on both sides of the river, one off of Shelburne Falls Road and the other one at Jack Lockhead's. With some of the technology that's out there, we originally thought that Jack's area was too small, but we've come to realize that with some of the, like a bottomless sand filter or whatever the technology is, that we can get the full usage of Jack's site. So I had approached Jack, come on, you should be thinking about the monetary compensation or how can we move ahead to the next step? And he responded saying that he was looking for some help with the CR. So I thought it'd be best if we discussed it directly with Jack. I really don't know the details, whether he's talking about the whole parcel or parcel. Okay. So
we're looking to do a leach field on Jack's
property. As you're coming up the hill, it would be on the left-hand side, sort of where the snowmobile trail is, up in that area, up on that knoll.
It's basically the town sledding hill.
Suicide hill.
So one of the questions, a little higher, maybe.
Yeah.
I don't have the details.
You don't have the details.
So it has to be pumped.
It's going to be up there. There's probably going to be some mounding involved. Mm-hmm. With the bottomless sand filter. I'll try to get you the detail as soon as I can.
Because we would be interested in that, and I think one of our concerns would be that if it's mounded, it's done in a way that when it's finished, it looks pretty natural.
Exactly.
So it might be moving more dirt to get it done, but...
That might be something they could probably place into the side hill somehow.
But it might make the hill a little longer. But our concern is that we have about 230 acres altogether, mostly woodland behind the house, and we have it now in 61 with active forest, but we would like to eventually put it into some kind of a more permanent conservation restriction on most of the property. I think we would leave some near the road for as possible building or whatever. But the bulk of it we would like to be able to put. And I am aware that the select board has a yes/no on any of these conservation restrictions. So our interest is that if this comes about, and it's a long way to go before it would come about, that we're not concerned about getting any money from the town for the ability to do this, but we would like to have an agreement with the select board that we can conserve the rest of the property, or most of the rest of the property.
That
sounds equitable. You're paying taxes on all the property now, under 61?
Under 61 you do pay taxes.
It's not much, though.
But it's not much. Now that's another issue, is it's actually 61A in that area because it's grazing land. There might be some, if this digging process required taking it out of 61, and I'm not clear that it would, because it might be an allowed use since it's essentially underground, then there would be some tax implications, and I think it's not going to be a lot of money, but we'd like to at least not be hit with a bill for that. I should make clear that we did get a landowner improvement grant back, well, we had it for 5 years from 2005 to 2010. And that puts a lien on the property that it can only be used for its current use for 10 years. Mm-hmm. After 10 years, the lien's gone. But that means that if this goes ahead before 2020, there could be, at, a technical problem with that. I can't imagine going ahead before 2020.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be here tomorrow.
It was 2020. It was 10 years after 2005? It was 10 years after 2005?
No, after 2010. That was the last year that we got one of these grants.
Is that through the town, the grant?
It's a federal grant program.
It's through the state.
Oh, well, that's right. It's federal money dished out by the state.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you can always look into that.
I'm sure all these things can be worked out satisfactorily.
And thank you. I want to say thank you, too.
Yeah, that's great.
That'd be wonderful.
That's great. Well, Joe is driving this.
It'll be town meeting that'll drive it. But we are hoping to present at town meeting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. At this point, I don't know that we're going to be asking for money. I don't know that we're that far along. But we would probably like to at least present where we are.
The consultant's trying to
where we are.
Have you found?
If you've got a couple million you're throwing around, you can throw them our direction.
we're looking for a couple million for somewhere, believe me.
Yeah, gosh.
Where on the other side of Shelburne Falls Road?
Well, I was hoping the housing committee was here so we could talk about it. We're actually, I guess I can tell you, but we're going to propose at this point a joint with the housing committee.
Okay.
That we've done enough work to feel that we can take care of the housing and the community leach field on the Rose property. Our consultant has been working with Berkshire Design on the...
That'll still be out of the flood zone?
That's what they're saying. That's what they're telling us at this point.
It would have to be out of the flood zone.
Damn tight.
But again, you might have to build up.
It might be a mounted system. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Mm.
But there's also some news forthcoming, I think, from the housing people.
Okay.
May change how it all plays out. So.
All right.
Mm-hmm. But that's currently our selection.
And how many houses would be served by all of this?
Each one can do, I think it's 90 bedrooms. It's 110 gallons per day per bedroom.
And part of the rationale of doing this is for businesses to be able to be built in town.
Businesses are actually less than homes.
Well, built businesses are less.
They're done by square footage. Mm-hmm. A home has to be done...
By
3-bedroom minimum, so even a 1-bedroom home would be 330 gallons.
But if somebody opened a restaurant...
It's like 75 gallons per 1,000 square feet, so it actually would go down if you converted out into a restaurant. Interesting.
Just like my store, the average is about 85 gallons a day.
Really? That's all?
As you would think.
They're saying...
You would think a restaurant would be...
They're saying 75 gallons.
Particularly one that sells beer, you would think it would be. A big number in the system.
Good point, Jack. Very good point. Yeah. Okay.
Well, no, so, with roughly 33 homes is the way we've been figuring. 33 businesses on each side.
All right. Well, that's great.
That's not... how's those numbers work out with the homes in the center of town? They all pretty much can fit into it?
Yeah, we've done some preliminary work, but the consultant will actually be doing a proposed piping layout to show which houses would be served. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it'll do the whole town. It's not going to do the whole downtown. It's pretty much Main Street. You know, we're not going up onto Academy Hill or Upper Baptist.
This would be done according to whether the landowner would like to participate or not.
Those are the sticky details that we're working on.
It would probably have to be an all or none situation.
Yeah, I mean, probably have to pay a betterment, but we're trying to be sensitive to people like Silverman, for instance, who spent $30,000+ a few years ago. But how do we? Just tell him that, okay, you know.
Isn't that what Asheville's done? They those people that are on the system pay a betterment fee for that.
I think when you get the pipe and the opportunity to hook up, you pay a betterment. In theory, your house is more valuable.
Special assessment.
I think that's what I said.
All right.
I think most towns would set up it's called an enterprise fund, and they would take in revenue. But we have to. We're actually having. I think I sent Tom an email. We're having a meeting with a federal or state funded consultant who's going to come in and talk to us. He would also, while I'm here, like to do a income survey on the downtown. The average per capita income in Conway is high enough that we don't qualify for any grants, but we qualify for low-interest loans. In some towns, they've been able to assess the income of the area that's being served by the pipe, and if that income is lower, then you can use those numbers.
You find that a lot in the economy.
And so you, and I don't know if the incomes are lower in this part of town, but if they were low enough, then we might qualify for direct grant.
In general, a couple of outliers along, depending on where.
Outliers, maybe more.
Outliers, yeah.
And you do have a copy of that email.
Right. Yes. So we might need one more house to sign up to make the numbers come out right. Yeah. But we'll be discussing that, and there'll be some kind of publicity about that.
Right.
Okay. Okay. Survey. Yeah. And it's an anonymous survey. It's not being done by the town. It'll be done by an independent group.
Right. Mm-hmm. Thank you guys for coming.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, no, that could be a nice thing.
Yeah.
To get this done. Thank you, guys.
Just have a good day. That's all.
Good luck.
Put it in the long range plan. Right?
Yeah, we got a long range plan, right? We're going broke.
Yeah. All right, next item on our agenda is to
appoint Susan.
To appoint Susan Schroeder to the Agricultural Commission. We had appointed her as an alternative, as an alternate member.
Right.
Now we're going to.
This is a permanent.
They're recommending
a permanent
member.
I will note that they also requested that a family member of somebody who was already on the committee be appointed. I was talking that over with John, and I think what we need is a policy on what to do about people from the same family being on a single committee. The concern is that there is undue influence on.
Well, on two on the voting business, rights there too. You know, you look at
on the business of the committee. So that's something for the board to discuss, and I'll try to have something on that as soon as I can for you, because, you know, any one example you might say, well, that's fine, but to set a precedent then, it might not be such a good idea. Yeah. So I think the board needs to discuss that separately.
Now, Susan is. Was a previous member. Now she wants to be a permanent member, correct?
Yes.
Or is she
a voting member?
Is
voting
she member. Taking up a slot where somebody resigned, or do they have more?
Well, they have one vacancy, didn't they?
Yeah, they have.
They had one vacancy.
Yeah, they have a vacancy, yeah. Certainly.
So is she filling a vacancy?
Yes.
My question.
Yes. 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 Yeah.
I think we already approved her as an.
I know we did as an alternate, but there was, at the time there was no. Opening for her to become permanent, I don't think.
I think there was. She didn't want to be at the beginning.
She didn't want to be first, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I move that you sign that, John.
Okay. Yeah, well, I'll make a motion that we appoint Susan as a member of the Agricultural Commission.
Second.
To end on 6:30 of this year.
Wait.
Okay. Second, Jim.
Yep.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That's not going to give much time, huh?
We'll reappoint everybody. Last time you had asked for a written proposal on restructuring the fire chief pay. I've written down my reasons for thinking that that's the right thing to do at this point. The ambulance director gets a stipend plus hourly pay. We just heard that we should change all of our stipends to hourly pay, but that's going to be, I think, a long conversation.
Yeah,
very long.
Pending that, in order to keep things fair, I would like to provide what I would call internal equity between those two positions and not have them treated differently. And rather than ask the ambulance director to not take hourly pay, which we've just promised her, to me the fair solution seems to be to allow the fire chief to receive hourly pay for call-outs, mm-hmm. which is therefore my recommendation.
Yeah. Have you read that?
Yeah.
You've read this? Okay.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we accept the recommendation of our town administrator and raise the fire chief's situation to be consistent with that of the ambulance director as far as hourly pay for call-outs. Do I have a second?
I second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I swear I heard a recusal from Bob.
Yes, you did.
No,
Bob,
yes, you did.
Bob didn't, I didn't hear
I
a word
my
from
tongue.
Bob.
Did, yeah, I think I did. Did I go get Jim? Go get Jim?
Yeah. All right, next item. Let's see. Next item is anything not anticipated in 48 hours, Tom?
No.
Okay, your update, Tom?
Quick.
No, we're showing. We got a lot of them here. This one sheet.
Right? Yeah, as you know from what Joe just said, they're having a meeting coming up in the Wastewater Committee on March 9th at 7 p.m. There will be a presentation by a consultant builder regarding possible funding for the downtown wastewater proposal. The committee is hoping to move forward with the completion of their feasibility study.
Is that the town hall?
I don't know. I imagine it will be, actually.
Probably, yeah.
And they hope to present their report at town meeting in May. For departments, Maya has announced that it will be giving credit for attending certain meetings of the Small Town Administrators of Massachusetts. That would be my department. As well as having points for a STAM-certified administrator. And I did get my peer certification from that group.
That's going to help all our insurance rates.
Congratulations.
And
that's
so
good. Congratulations.
We'll get money off, more money off than I get back in mileage, I'll put it that way.
Good.
So a net gain for the town.
Okay.
On the budget, I've asked Marty Barrett if she can come in March 21st or 28th for a budget meeting. I did send out a memo earlier today saying I've invited Ron Sweet in for next Monday with the Finance Committee over at the Town Hall.
Right, okay.
So starting the budget hearings next week. Marty Barrett's presentation will cover both the Grammar School and Frontier. Mm-hmm. And I am pleased to announce, I'm relieved to announce, I have completed the budget for fiscal year 2017. Please look at it for next week. And we are slated to meet with the Finance Committee. Please let me know if you see any errors that need to be corrected.
I have the one, yeah.
That's right.
This is the print of the email you sent us?
Yes.
Easier to read.
That's the revised version, especially on a little mobile, huh?
Yeah.
I plan to put it on the website tomorrow. Again, if you catch any errors, please let me know. Other business?
These are still subject to change, correct?
Oh, but this is what I'm presenting.
This is preliminary.
And now you take your knives to it. we have had some interest expressed by Verizon in providing cell service to the Village Center of Conway. They have hired a firm, NBNC, to identify possible sites for a new cell tower. Current service is provided by AT&T from the water tower at Orchard Equipment. They'll be doing a test at the transfer station on Thursday. That's a location they think they can work with. I'm not sure they realize it's all ledge in the middle, but a little ledge never stopped a good pole from going up. Maybe we can get them to blast the whole thing for us.
That'd be nice, make it level.
They're planning to come in and put up a 100-foot pole with a transmitter on top of it and drive around town and see where they can get a signal.
Mm-hmm.
This would be in addition to the AT&T service?
Yes.
Okay.
This is Thursday, probably about 11 o'clock. Ron's going to open it up for them, and they're going to do the test. The test will take 3 or 4 hours, mm-hmm. in case anybody asks you what's going on in there.
Right.
The Franklin Regional Council of Governments River Corridor Management Project, the other South River project, not the one down here by Jim's house, which is also managed by Kimberly McPhee, would like a second joint meeting. You may remember there was a meeting and we invited the Ashfield Select Board.
Right, yeah.
She would like a second joint meeting between the Conway and Ashfield Select Boards, probably either March 15th or 29th. Those were dates that I suggested that I thought would be possible for you all to do it. And we're waiting still to hear back from Ashfield. Last time, I think it might have been only Ron Kohler came down.
But I know there was another Ashfield Select Board member, too.
There were two Select Board members.
There were two, but there weren't three. So we're trying to see. We're not exactly sure where it would be. They came down here last time. Maybe it would be up there. On the other hand, we haven't heard back from
them.
Keep
us informed.
So Kimberly needs to do another check-in meeting before this cycle of the grant goes through. So she really needs it done by the end of March. So we're hoping to have some kind of a meeting in which people are invited anyway. I thought that the 15th or the 29th would be probably the best for you all, and we have yet to hear from Ashfield.
Okay.
Okay.
That sounds good.
And that's it for me.
Thank you, Tom.
All right, thanks.
Next item is concerns of the selectmen. Do we have any concerns tonight, selectmen? No? Hearing none? We'll skip to the next item. I don't see any mail, and we have no announcements. Next scheduled meeting.
There is one piece of mail.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is an important piece of mail.
Oh.
Okay, this is from the chairman of the 250th anniversary committee. She's looking for a recipe from the selectmen for the 250th anniversary cookbook. Do any of you have a recipe you can give her?
Sure.
Traditional Conway recipes, you know, that would be the
best. Oh, mine is
right, Jim,
traditional
Jim, then,
Conway.
Then you can,
I'll
you can,
give her
you can
her
do barbecue.
Recipe.
You can do barbecue.
John, can
I'm not giving anybody my barbecue.
Jim, you can enter one for the Board of Selectmen. How's that?
That's right.
Okay. I'll do
good
one.
Man.
All right.
Thank you, Tom.
Well,
I almost missed that email, Tom.
I have
you.
A lot of...
Well...
recipe.
A little bit of this and a little bit of that.
But they're not ever the same. I go by taste.
Yeah.
All right. Next meeting is next Monday, February 29th.
Town Hall, huh?
And, in Town Hall.
That's across the way.
Yep. There is no need for an executive session tonight.
Good.
I will make a motion that we adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.